Welcome to the Bethel Park TV Art Exhibition, where we will be presenting talented local artists displaying their works. My name is Patricia Anthony, and I hope you enjoy our show. Featured guest today is Kristen Normile. Kristen is a very active member of our community, and she's the author of a new book just released about the history of Bethel Park. She is a graduate of the Art Institute of Pittsburgh and Point Park University. She is also a wife and mom and very active in her PTO, a trustee of the Bethel Park Community Foundation. She is an artist, a commercial photographer. I could go on and on, but this is only a half an hour show. So welcome, Kristen.
Thank you, Pat. It's great to be here. Such a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
I'm sure this is a unique experience for you to write an entire book. I bet it was very challenging, and I'd like you to tell myself and the audience about the process of writing an entire book.
It was actually a very unique experience. It was a fun experience. I originally started working with the community foundation, the Bethel Park Community Foundation, about almost 6 years ago now. I'll be in my sixth year. And there was talk about doing a book already on the table. More of like a coffee table book for a fundraiser. And then while all this talk was going on, Arcadia Publishing, who publishes all the Images of America books for across the country, asked if there was anybody interested in doing a book for them. So that's how that all came about. And I said I'd absolutely do it. I love Bethel Park and I love my country. The cover of the book was actually chosen by Arcadia Publishing. I had to submit five photographs and they got to choose. However, I really am glad that they chose the Bethel Presbyterian Church because that's where it all started. And if you can tell on the cover, the church is here and you can still see the graveyard. This picture was taken in 1895, so this was the third church of Bethel Presbyterian Church. There were actually four. This was the third meeting house. And on the back cover, you can see where the cemetery is, and on the front, you can see where Bethel Church Road comes down and church goes this way. And it's a great picture to depict where Bethel all started. It started by trying to put together all the stories and all the history behind Bethel Park, the origins, how it went from agricultural to industrial with the coal and everything. So I started out with just trying to find pictures. I think that was the biggest part of it. Arcadia Publishing has a minimum of 128 pictures and a maximum of 248 pictures. So I went to the Historical Society, and believe it or not, they didn't actually have a huge amount of pictures there. So. But the people were willing to help me in any way they could. And Pat and Dick Kraft, who run the Bethel Presbyterian Church Historical Room, started with me, and that's where it all began. We went over to the Historical Room at Bethel Presbyterian Church, and they have a bunch of wonderful historical documentations and letters and memorabilia and photography. So a lot of the first chapter of the book, which is called The Church and the Fort, started inside Bethel Presbyterian Church. Back in the 1770s, Reverend John McMillan came over from the East Coast into the Western Pennsylvania area, which was mostly wilderness and filled with Indians. And he came over to sort of civilize the religious aspect of the growing population of the area down at the Oliver Miller Homestead in South Park. His congregation grew so big that he actually divided it into two congregations, the Eastern Division and the Western Division. The Eastern Division he named Lebanon, and the Western Division he named Bethel. And the church up at Bethel Presbyterian Church is Bethel Church. That's how it got its name. The cemetery has also been there even since before the incorporation of Bethel Park in 1886. There's some Revolutionary War soldiers buried there. There's Civil War soldiers buried there. There's all kinds of great history. So if you get a chance, go up and check it out, especially the historical room. It was fun. So that's how the church came about. And then the fort was, of course, Fort Couch, which is now where the McDonald's is on Fort Couch Road. The fort down on Fort Couch was actually the old Pioneer Inn and was a big part of the Whiskey Rebellion back in the late 1700s. And on July 15th, 1794, farmers of the region met at the Pioneer Inn, or where the Pioneer Inn was and where the McDonald's is now, to gather together to march on General John Neville's house at Bower Hill Road to protest the whiskey tax, which is now known as the Whiskey Insurrection or the Whiskey Rebellion. A lot of the Pioneer Inn included the original fireplace and some of the log timbers from the fort, and eventually was torn down, and now Alums was there, and then now the McDonald's is there. Beyond that, that was the first chapter. We wanted to make sure that people understood where Bethel Park really started, and it really started in that area. The second chapter of the book is life in the coal mines. It's life in a mining town. That's when it took us from agricultural into the industrial era. The transportations of the railroads started to come in, transportation from the trolleys from Pittsburgh out to Bethel Park and into Washington. They all started moving people this way, and people started moving in and working in the mines. It wasn't until probably the 1900s, until the beginning of the 1900s, till when coal started to become a big business, and Pittsburgh Terminal Coal came into Bethel Park and built its Mollenhauer mine and then its model mining community of Coverdale. Coverdale was Pittsburgh Terminal Coal's baby. It had over 200 model mining houses and employed most of what was the original Bethel Park. It was over in the industrial park area, where the industrial park area is now, and all the homes around it on Main and Hickory and Maple are all the old homes of the area. That was one of the fascinating things, because in 1921, when they did build Coverdale, there was a lot of what was going on in the country right here in Bethel Park. Things like Prohibition came around, and there were speakeasies, and there was corruption in government. It was a very interesting time in the United States, and it fell here in Bethel as well. A lot of what I found interesting about it is that there wasn't a huge amount of segregation. They were all coal miners first before there was any ethnic division. They were all coal miners. They all worked together, and at the end of the day, they all had the soot on their face, and they washed in the same place, and they did what they had to do. And I think that's a unique part of Bethel that's still here today, that we are neighbors before anything else, and we enjoy each other's company.
Western Pennsylvania Humane Society.
We are here to tell you about our Girl Scout Gold Word Project.
As you can see, these animals are very lovable, but there's a problem here at the Humane Society.
They do not have enough wet food to give to their animals.
And that's where you guys come in.
We are asking for your help through a generous donation to the Western Pennsylvania Humane Society. At this time, we have collected over 1,000 cans and donated them to the Humane Society, but they still need more. These animals need their food so they can continue to have healthy, full lives before they are adopted out to a loving home.
Another way you can help out is by adopting an animal from the shelter.
Thank you for your time and attention, and I hope that you have the consideration to remember the animals at the Western Pennsylvania Humane Society.
Sports, TV shows.
What's in the box? In the box. Issue.
Chapter of the book is life beyond the coal mines. It's when the coal mines started, a lot of the businesses started developing around Bethel Park. The developments brought in places like Bethel Bakery and Brookside Lumber and Kiefer Coal and Supply, and a lot of the old places that are actually still around today. And a lot of the photographs in the book depict what they were like back then. Miller's Hardware, all of that. A lot of the book was based on a lot of the information that all these people gave me. And I am truly appreciative of everybody who helped. It was certainly a collaborative effort. A lot of the families, like the Wells family, the Edwards family, the Virgili family, the Tischlers, the Hennies, the Radnicks, the Gurdiches, the Yugo clubs, the police department, the fire department, the school, they all helped in putting this together. So when I say I did the book, I think the community did the book. I just happened to be the one to put it together. Chapter 4 is actually called Trolleys, Trestles, Tunnels, and Trains. And it's basically the transportation that is Bethel Park. The Montour Railroad, the Port Authority, all the trolleys and the trains and all the tunnels that used to be here and all the trestles that used to be here as well. They were a big part of Bethel and its expansion. People came out via the transportation and the trolleys, and that's what helped Bethel Park to grow. The trains, all for the coal mining. All the tunnels that used to be around that they took out that were on the Montour Trail, They were taken out back in the 1980s, and a lot of the trestles were too, to help with future expansion and growth. A lot of people have said, why did they take those tunnels out? But the truth of the matter is that the height and the clearance on them were just not conducive to having the needs of the community met with bigger transports and things like that. So it's nice to see, though, that the trail, the Montour Trail that was once used to grow this community is now used by the community to do a lot of walking and biking and all kinds of fun things like that. And apparently, I guess, will be part of the connection between Pittsburgh and Washington, D.C. for that whole huge trail. I think that's a big plus in Bethel Park's cap. Chapter 5 deals with all the schools. We started here back in 1886, the district, with 4 elementary level schools. The Bethel Grade School, the King School, Irish Town School, and the Proco School, all established back in 1886. And as the community grew and more people came in, things like the schoolhouse were added, Bethel High School, which was over on Park Avenue where the community center is now. The high school, which was built back in 1958, actually as a joint venture between Bethel School District and the community college, which at the time was only a night school. However, that fell through, so that's why we have our Bethel Park High School campus. And it also takes us into the future, where we now have our new high school being built for opening in 2012. The sixth chapter is called Faces and Places and just deals with what we know as Bethel Park, the people, the houses, the businesses, and the places that we've grown to love. The seventh one is a really important one to me, which is to honor and serve, which really recognizes the police department, the fire department, the veterans, and the people who have served our community well and given us what we have so far. Again, a lot of the book was put together by a lot of different people in Bethel Park. Photographies, stories. I went door to door a lot this summer with Jamie Amrine, who is a Notre Dame graduate of history there, and she came home this summer and helped me do a lot of the research and the organization for it. Thank you, Jamie. We were able to put all this information together and put it into the book. I had a very short timeline, an 8-month timeline to get it all together, so I really appreciate everybody opening their doors, all the businesses, all the residents who helped make this possible. The book came out in February and is available at Evie's Hardware, Bethel Bakery, and the Bethel Park Library, and all the proceeds from those sales benefit the Community Foundation as well. Half of the proceeds go back to the Community Foundation. It is also available at Barnes & Noble, Walgreens, Amazon.com, and a lot of the other national outlets. However, the ones that are for sale in the community, at Evie's, at the library, and at Bethel Bakery, the money and the proceeds go back into the community, and I really like that aspect of it. So if you want to go pick one up there, they will have their copies. Interesting story also about the book is that while I was writing the back cover for it, I was doing the math and realized that it is this year in 2011, it is the 125th anniversary of Bethel Park. So I went to the mayor's office and said, hey, Mayor Morton, do you realize this is 125 years? And he went, nah, we just had the 100th a while ago. And I said, yeah, 125 years ago. And he was like, wow, we should do something. So right now we do have a committee that we're organizing a lot of fun events for the community to celebrate Bethel Park's 125th anniversary. I've been a resident of Bethel Park for over 10 years now, and grew up a little bit in Bethel in my third and fourth grade year at John McMillan. My grandparents moved here back in 1955, and my mother, my two aunts, and my uncle all graduated from Bethel High School. So I have deep roots here, and though I didn't graduate from Bethel, I have a Bethel heart. And that's what started this all too, is just my love for my community. I remember trick-or-treating around Oakhurst when I was little. Lynn Swan lived in our neighborhood, and if you grew up in the 70s and 80s, you knew that was a really big deal. And so it was always fun to go trick-or-treating at his house and see what he had to give the kids. And just the neighbors were all wonderful, and I always wanted to come back, so I did. And now I am very pleased and happy to have my son Zachary here at these schools and growing up in these neighborhoods. We live in the Boxer Heights section, which is a wonderful place with all the kids and the families and everything like that.
Welcome to BPTV, your home of the HD revolution. There's never been a better time to join us at BPTV and make the shows you want to watch. Maybe there's a special event you'd like to see, or a sport you want to see on TV. BPTV, you can use our equipment make you look like a pro. BPTV, you can make almost anything you can imagine. Maybe you'd like to come to our studios and film a talk show, or go on location, film an action adventure movie or comedy movie, which will help you put up on YouTube or Google Video, or even burn your own DVDs. So join us at BPTV, the Pulse of Bethel Park. We're waiting for you.
Indoor tanning was safe.
They said their tanning rays were less likely to cause a sunburn.
What you need to know is UV light from indoor tanning
can cause premature aging.
And even worse, UV light can increase your risk of skin cancer,
including melanoma, the deadliest form of skin cancer.
In fact, current estimates are that 1 in 5 Americans develop skin cancer.
One person dies from melanoma about every hour.
I don't want to be one of them.
This message brought to you by the American Academy of Dermatology.
Again, the name of the book is called Bethel Park. It's part of Arcadia Publishing's Images of America series. And I want to thank everybody for helping with it, and it was an absolute privilege to write it. A lot of people have asked me if there's a number 2 coming out, and there's definitely enough information and enough stories out there that if you want to contact me, we can definitely talk about putting something together. I think we were talking about a then and now book, pictures and photographs of things from prior years and pictures today. So feel free to contact me and we will work more.
Today we're talking about helping you protect your identity from identity theft. We're going to do that with State Representative Matt Smith. You have an important event that could help many of your constituents. Can you tell us about it?
Yeah, well, last year, Kevin, we did a shredding event in Greentree, and it was
tremendously well received. We had, I think, we were able to shred over 5 tons of paper, documents that individuals had retained, some for 50, 60 years. We were shocked at some of the documents we were able to shred. And it was so well received last year. We're going to do it again, same location. We're doing it in conjunction with Green Tree Borough, who has been a tremendous partner on this event. And it will be from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. on Saturday, May 14th, in the lower parking lot of Green Tree Park, and that's 895 Green Tree Road in Green Tree. And yeah, we, same as last year, we're telling individuals to bring documents such as documents that have social security numbers, credit card statements, credit card applications, bank statements, canceled checks, any documents with income tax information, any insurance records that they have, really anything that an individual is concerned about in terms of identity theft. Because I really feel like this this type of event accomplishes two goals. It does, number one, it's great for the environment because we're recycling all of the paper. And as I said, last year, over 5 tons. All of that paper will be recycled and put back into the system. So we're doing something that I think is great for the environment on one hand. And the second goal that I think it accomplishes is we're protecting people from identity theft. It's a big issue for a lot of individuals, particularly seniors in Western Pennsylvania and in the 42nd Legislative District. And we want to make sure that those seniors and all individuals and families have the peace of mind in knowing that their private information, whether it's health information, social security information, financial information, is protected, and that they're not just putting it out to the curb where someone could possibly obtain access to that information. We want to make sure that that information is disposed of properly, completely shredded. We have a professional shredding company, the Paper Exchange, coming to partner with us to do the event, and they'll do the event. They're doing the shredding free of charge. So if anyone wants to come, bring boxes, bring documents, we're more than happy to do it. And as I said, last year, it was tremendously well received, and we're really looking forward to doing it again on May 14th.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, it's a free event, and the shredding happens right there on site. It's not as though the documents are being taken somewhere else.
Yeah, individuals have the choice. They can leave the box there and you know, go on their way. We have a system where all someone has to do is basically pull up to the truck that we have. We'll take the boxes off. They can go away and not see the documents shredded, or we have the option that individuals can drop the box off and actually see their documents being shredded so that they have that peace of mind that those documents were shredded. So as you said, free event Saturday, May 14th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. in Green Tree Park, 895 Green Tree Road. And we're very excited about offering this service again this year to the constituents of the 42nd District.
Well, if anybody has any questions, how can they get hold of you?
They can get a hold of me either through my website, www.pahouse.com/msmith, or calling the office at 412-571-2169.
All right. Sounds like a great event. Thank you for telling us about it, and we'll see you at the free shredding event.
Hi, I'm Greg Poge, and this is The Plan.
And I'm Mike Shaheen, also known as Bill Cosby.
BPTV is in desperate need of volunteers, new TV shows, and even your own short films.
Like on YouTube.
For example, you can send your own YouTube videos, and we'll gladly put them on the air.
Right, because I just said that like 3 seconds ago.
We can show you all the tools you need to create your own TV show.
Like Photoshop, Final Cut, or After Effects.
A lot of the equipment we have at BPTV is the same equipment used by professionals in your favorite TV programming.
Shows such as Scrubs or Mythbusters.
We'll even take you step by step through the creation of your own show. Plus, you get to meet a bunch of fun people who enjoy doing the same thing, like us.
Yeah.
We really need some new material for BPTV.
Yeah.
I mean, the only people working are me and this plan.
Yeah. Wait, what?
That's right, just me and this plan.
Greg, I'm right here.
It's really hard to come up with ideas whenever we just have me and this plan here.
Greg, we're filming a video right now. I mean, we sat here for an hour writing this script out. Can the camera even see me?
Like
hello?
I said, come to BPTV and help me and this plan make some good television. Because clearly, no one else is here.
Greg, I'm right here. Hello? Oh, come on.
This year, 1 in 3 older Americans will fall at home, risking a potentially lethal hip fracture.
For information on making your home safer, visit orthoinfo.org. A message from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons.